Hey, brother Wars and sisters, this is your favorite brother from another mother. Hallelujah. Coming to you from the fabulous city area of Rochester in the luxuriously non-Christian state of New York. Hallelujah. But I came to bring the gospel to this place. Hallelujah. By the grace of God, by the power of God. Hallelujah. I just want to share with you what's in my spirit from the Lord. And that is that it's like Peter when he got on the water, to have revival, to get answered prayer. If you need to be physically healed, mentally healed, spiritually healed, if you need deliverance, if you need salvation, if you need whatever it is, answered prayer, pick a topic. You know, you need a job. You know, your vehicle's broke, you need a new vehicle. There's people that's got all kinds of problems. There's lots of people that keep, you know, of course, even myself, you know, we want to keep the gospel all about the Lord. But in Christ, he's our Mashiach, our Messiah. And in that is everything, our healer, our deliverer, our savior. So in the modern day world, in the ancient world, people, you know, needed a mule or whatever, to a donkey to make their farming and all that, and to travel to even the Virgin Mary rode on the back of a donkey to go to Bethlehem because she was great with child. And so we need today, the modern day equivalent of that is a vehicle. People need vehicles. And so a lot of times we think, well, you know, people think that, that's a frivolous prayer, but it's not. The Lord cares about our needs in this life and in the life to come, as he said. You'll have all the things you need, houses and wells and vineyards in this life and the life to come, he told Peter, with tribulation or with troubles, with turbulence in our life. That's the way it is in this life. As long as you're in the flesh, you will have tribulation. Not the tribulation, but tribulation in your life. That's what one of the first times the Lord, you know, when I started my prayer journal, January the 7th, 2001, the first thing the Lord told me to write in my journal, because I wrote down sometimes dreams and things that the Lord showed me and all that. And the very first thing was, settle it therefore in your heart. As long as you're in the flesh, you will have tribulation. We are living in a fallen world. The answer to all your questions, why does good things happen to bad people? Why do people get cancer? All those things you can think of, because we're living in a fallen world. Until the Lord returns, then it will be said, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? These things are swallowed up in victory at the resurrection, aka we call it the rapture, the snatching away, the harpoza. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16, 17, 18, will be caught up. That's the word in Latin, rapturo, to be caught up. Until that is the finish of the first resurrection. Jesus and those people at that time were the first fruits of the resurrection, but the first resurrection will be complete at the rapture of the church. And then the second resurrection is for those who will be judged, brothers and sisters, at the end of the age. Blessed are those who take part in the first resurrection, the Bible says. Anyway, I'm not trying to get into theology here. I'm trying to share this with you. So here's the secret to answer to your prayers and everything else. Peter walking on the water. Go look at your text. A lot of people, you'll hear Christians and sometimes even preachers saying, well, you know, Peter lost his faith and started looking at the storm around him. The Bible says that, you know, Jesus came walking to the disciples on the Sea of Galilee during a storm, and they were afraid. They thought it was a spirit, like a ghost or whatever. And so Jesus said to them, fear not, it is I. And then Peter said, if it be thee, Lord, bid me to come unto you, call me to come out to you. And so Jesus spoke the word. Our faith always, and I can do a whole message. Let me make it quick, because I got to go do some baptisms. Praise God. I'm doing some baptisms here in the Rochester area, and I got to leave here in a few minutes. So let me, praise God. The Lord's already, we're already bearing fruit here. First day. Should be doing, I think it's 3 or 4 baptisms this afternoon. Anyway, so we stand on the word. When you receive your healing or whatever it is your answer prayer is, you need a vehicle, you know, to get to work, or you need a job, you know, et cetera, whatever it is in your life, your kid to be, to get in a good school and whatever it is, anything you can think of. The Lord is here for us. He loves us. He wants to bless us. So we stand on the word of God. So Jesus, who is the word of God, he literally spoke a word, because Peter said, if it is you, bid me to come unto you. And Jesus said, come. Peter, as they say, he walked on the word, you know, that Jesus spoke, you know, come on. Jesus gave him the command or the permission. Come on. So Peter walked on that word. It was spoken instantly when Jesus was walking, when he was speaking it. I mean, it was instantly spoken. I mean, we've got the written word right now that's still the same, quick and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword. Hebrews 4:12. It divides asunder even the thoughts and intents of your heart. So the Lord knows if you're in faith. He knows if you're in fear. He knows if you believe. The word of God divides the thoughts and intents of our heart. So the Lord knows exactly what's going on. If you're playing with him, people play with sin. You know, and people ask me about that all the time. Let me just say that. I need to finish up what I'm talking about, Peter. But let me say this. Many times people sin, and then the Lord doesn't chastise them. And then sometimes people sin, and the Lord's so quick to chastise them. Why? Different things. The Lord divides asunder the thoughts and intents of our hearts. So there are people who slip into sin by accident. You know, it's not planned, premeditated, pre-planned. So people who are these people who are spiritually tone deaf and do not have the Spirit of the Lord in them, they will say, you know, well, sin is sin. It's true, but the Lord divides every little thought and intent, brothers and sisters, to whom much given, much is required. There are people that were born, you know, and their parents were drug addicts. Their parents beat them. Their parents abandoned them, or whatever happened to them. They were molested. They were, you know, God forbid, whatever bad things happened to them. God accounts all those things. No, is there an excuse for sin? No. But the Lord knows the very makeup of our thoughts. In other words, someone that's been taught to hate and raised in a home with criminals, and then they, you know, as a child, they have that mind. That's what they've been taught. The Lord takes all those things into consideration of what's happened to somebody. It's not black and white the way you think or the way I think. It's the way the Lord, the Bible says, just as the heavens and earth, heavens are above the earth, so are my ways above your ways. So God said they're beyond your reach. You can't understand the way I think. Just like he, you know, explained to Job. Why God does things, we don't know. We live in a fallen world, and God knows best. Like the old TV show from the 1950s, Father Knows Best. No matter what they show you on TV about women being in charge and men being bumbling fools and all this stuff, Father, the Father, always knows best. Hallelujah. And if a man is, if a godly man is following God, he will be a father who knows best. He will be walking, knows best. If he's following the Lord, he can lead his family in following the Lord. Just as Paul said, follow me as I follow the Lord. The apostle Paul, of course, was walking with the Lord. He said to the people in one of his letters, follow me, be a follower of me as I am a follower of Christ. Hallelujah. So anybody that's following Christ, you can follow them. If you're lost and don't know where to go, that's why God gave the church. So people, and think about it. I mean, that's why God gave preachers, as it says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, and any Christian to be salt and light. What does that mean? Well, the world can only know the Lord through us. And that's why the Lord has given me the commission to announce that the American church, the Western church, has failed to be salt and light. If the American church was walking and leading the way and being salt and light, we would not have had 60 million abortions in America. And so when I give that message, I've had at least two different churches, one in Boise and in one in Fort Worth, to say, oh, we can't let this guy come in here. And specifically the pastor in Fort Worth said, he's nothing wrong with his preaching. It's just that he'll turn this place upside down. We know that half the people in this church is not born again. And if that guy comes in here, he's going to turn this place upside down and half the people might leave. So see, the motive is always to build their own kingdom and not have people follow you as you follow Christ. Brothers and sisters, don't be this way. You've got to keep your eyes on Jesus. And that's the message I came to give to individual level. I talked about the church a little bit. Let's bring it to the individual level. How to get your answered prayer. Any topic you choose, okay? As I said, we won't review it again. Physical healing is a great example because that's the one I was praying about when I got this kind of revelation from the Lord about this illumination of the Word. It says, and people run down Peter. I've heard many preachers running down Peter for he took his eyes off the Lord and started looking at the storm, and he sank. But let me tell you something. There was 12 disciples in the boat. There was one disciple that said, that had the guts, that had the intestinal fortitude to say, Lord, if it be ye, or be you, bid me to come unto you. That was Peter. Peter was the man. Even though Peter was, you know, was, it said other goofy stuff, you know, and Jesus said, Satan, get behind me. Satan was speaking through Peter after Peter was also the one to proclaim from heaven that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus told Peter, Satan has wished to sift you like wheat, but I prayed for you, and when you're restored, strengthen the brethren. So Peter was on fire, as Jesus said in to the Laodicean church. Peter was the example of not being lukewarm. He was on fire, and then he was doing some clowning, and then he was on fire, doing some clowning. And so this is the thing that we can learn. Number one, we're no better than Peter. I mean, Peter was a fisherman. You know, he wasn't, an educated man like Paul was, but he was a man that was after God's own heart. In the fact that, hey, he was just like he was all fired up to do something. And praise God for that. The Bible says it's easier to steer, you know, a moving cart than one that's not moving. And so Peter was moving, whether it was in the right direction or the wrong direction, he was ready. He was set on go. Praise God for that. So Peter was the man, and that's why God chose him to be the first one to preach the gospel on Pentecost and all those things, even after he had denied the Lord, because Peter had the guts. The rest of them, yeah, they didn't deny the Lord. People love to keep talking about, well, Peter denied the Lord. Those other guys didn't have the guts to get on the water. They didn't have the guts to be out front making mistakes. Peter was the one that pronounced that Jesus was the Christ and then turned around and said, don't die on the cross. And Jesus said, get behind me, Satan. Because Peter had the guts, man. He was out there. He was like a wild mule running, and the Lord was able to steer him. The other ones were like a mule that you can't get to move. You got to keep hitting with them a stick to make a move. You know? So, anyway, here's what we can get the lesson on Peter walking on the water is, don't take your eyes off Jesus. It's so very simple. And people say, yeah, amen, that's right. Don't take your eyes off Jesus. Yeah, right. Are you walking in complete victory? You know, it's just not, you know, the problem with lots of people is just all mental assent. And that's the whole thing with all these false converts in the church. It's all theoretical. It's all theoretical for people till they tell you, oh, you got cancer and you got 4 weeks to live. Then it's not theoretical anymore. Or you've got a child that's sick and dying, and then it's not a theory anymore. It's time to put your faith to the test. And brothers and sisters, this is what I'm talking about. This is a message from the Lord. Hallelujah. It's time to put your faith to the test. Do you really believe that if Jesus tells you, come out on the water, that you can walk on the water? Now, your situation of walking on the water might be life and death of sickness and disease. As a matter of fact, if the Lord hadn't reached down and picked up Peter, I mean, you think about it. Peter didn't know that Jesus would, or he probably didn't think that, oh, Jesus can stick out his hand and pick me up. Think about it. This is not a theory. You think about going and walking on a lake in the middle of the night, in the middle of a extreme storm. Now, they say that the way the wind blows down through there on the Sea of Galilee, it's a raging sea, even though it's not that big. You know, so many miles. I studied geography of the middle and of the Holy Land when I went to school. I can't remember now. But anyway, it's a small place. And the way that the land is there, it comes down to a valley there. You know, the low area where the Sea of Galilee is. They say when the storms come down through there, they're vicious. So you imagine you being out on the lake in a fishing boat. This is pre, you know, there's pre William Shatner and Rescue 911. This is pre, you know, 911. Okay, this is pre telephone, telegraph, whatever. If you were to go down, you are finished. I mean, there's no rescue coming, especially during the middle of the night, in the middle of a storm, 2,000 years ago. So here's the boat that's might be even be sunk. And then here's Peter. You can't walk on water. Who knows that you can't walk on water? This is impossibility. But God made a way. Hallelujah. He spoke it. And Peter, you could, I mean, I would, in the natural, you'd say, well, the guy's insane. Who would try to walk on water? I don't care who's out there walking on the water. There's some, you know, a lot of people say, well, you know, it's some kind of illusion or some kind of a trick, or I'm imagining it, or it's a, you know, this is a mirage or whatever. Who thinks that they can walk on water? Well, without God, of course, no one can walk on water. So every one of you have your literal water to walk on, or a, you know, a figurative water to walk on. So we all have that situation where we have to go walk on that tightrope across Niagara Falls. Now, I've done it many times. There's people that's done it much more than me in the ministry. I've had my times where I had to walk across that Niagara Falls on the tightrope. And there's times when I look down, brothers and sisters. We're all human, just like Peter. And we sink. And that's when we do like what Peter did. Help me, Lord. Lord, help me. And what did Jesus say? Oh, ye of little faith, why did you doubt? And the Lord laughed. So to walk on water and then look away in the middle of walking on water, the only person besides Jesus who walked on water, that, you know, in the Bible, I mean, there's people that have alleged to have walked on water since. There's some missionaries in, and I forgot where it was, that I'd read in a Christian magazine about them walking on water to escape some Muslim rebels. And it's supposed to be a true story. I don't know. But that's little faith. To go walk on water and then sink is little faith with the Lord. I mean, think about it. Think about it. Have you ever walked on water? Have you ever went to a hospital and somebody's laying there on their deathbed and you said, get up in the name of Jesus in front of everybody? And that's nothing. And working on water is much more serious than that. Literally walking on water. Today is your day. Sink or swim, as they say. Brothers and sisters, today is the day right now that you got to believe. We say we believe. We say we believe. And brothers and sisters, I mean, that's the thing about it. You know, like I say, I've been like Peter. I've looked away and all that. But I tell you the truth, that the secret, or the, you know, the answer. I prayed with thousands of people that were healed over my 19 years in the ministry, almost 19 years in the ministry, in the Philippines and all that. People deaf and dumb, a sister that was blind in Louisiana, and a sister with MS in down in South Carolina, and lots of things in the Philippines that were all like that. Lots of different miracles like that that God did through me. But why? Because there's that time, brothers and sisters, when the chips are down, you know, when it's all in against you, against all odds. There's the point where you don't have nothing else but Jesus. And the problem in the States is we're too fat and happy. We got the medical doctors. We've got, you know, all these things. You know, got welfare. You've got, you know, government assistance. You've got all these other things, whatever, to rely on and lean on instead of leaning on Jesus. So, you know, just think about this. If you, people say this, which is true, you know, well, we've got doctors today and all that. That's true. But think about this. What did people do even before World War II? Let's say less than 100 years ago, people got sick. They didn't have antibiotics. Antibiotics have only been available since the 1950s. I mean, they had sulfur drugs they came out with first about time of World War II. And then, so people could die of a simple infection before World War II. And that was our grandparents. They didn't have no option, but if the Lord didn't heal them, that's it. Less than 100 years ago. And here we are now, using those things as a crutch. This is why that the Western church is in such trouble. We've got too many natural blessings that the Lord has given us with these kind of crutches to use. And that's why they have revival and miracles in Africa and in the Philippines. The power of God is moving in these countries because they don't have an option. They don't have nowhere to go but to the Lord. Where could I go but to the Lord? That's a great song. Brothers and sisters, we have got to get our eyes on Jesus and get your eyes off of going to the doctor and get your eyes off of this and that and the enemy. And that's a whole nother vein where the enemy tries to stumble us, you know, through all these things. That's a whole nother level. And that's really what I was originally, you know, looking at this situation from. You know, the enemy tries to distract us, everybody, including myself, all ministries, all people. The Lord wants to get our eyes on, you know, someone's trying to defame us, or someone's trying to attack us, someone's trying to make trouble for us. It gets us in our, gets under our skin, gets us in the flesh to get mad. People did us wrong, etc., etc., etc. And brothers and sisters, I am determined not to let the devil's children stumble me or you by all these goofy things. As Paul said, we're not ignorant of the devil's devices. Don't be ignorant of his devices. Recognize. And that's a word that I need to get into and do a teaching on, you know, and I did make a video about it, you know, the law of recognition. And I say that not as some other ministry may have said it, but you've got to recognize when it's God, you've got to recognize when it's the enemy, and you got to recognize when it's just, you know, just the natural flow of events that happen, brothers and sisters, that the Lord allowed to happen. You got to recognize when it's the chastisement of the Lord versus the enemy trying to stumble you. And this is what we need to do. But in order to get there, the answer always is keeping your eyes on Jesus. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look in full in his wonderful face, and the things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of his glorious grace. Hallelujah. That's what you got to do. So I've got a few minutes before I leave. I got to leave, go do these baptisms. So I just want to, let's just worship the Lord for a minute. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I came to worship you. Yes, Lord. I came to sing your praise. I came to love you, Lord. Your holy name to praise. Hallelujah. Oh, how I worship you. Oh, how I sing your praise. Hallelujah. I came to love you, Lord, your holy name to praise. Yes, Lord Jesus. I came to worship you. Yes, Lord. I came to love you, Lord, your holy name to raise. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Bless his name. We love you, Lord. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Begin to thank and worship the Lord. Enter his gates with thanksgiving in your heart. Enter his courts with praise. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Lord. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Brothers and sisters, I got to get ready to run. I love you all very much. The victory is yours today. Victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Victory today is mine. Joy is mine. Joy is mine. Joy today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Joy today is mine. Hallelujah. You got to claim these things. Jesus said, since the time of John the Baptist till now, the kingdom of heaven is forcefully advanced, and the violent take it by force. You got to take it by force. You got to claim it, receive it, declare it. Hallelujah. I'm a child of the Most High God. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Every tongue that rises up against me, thou shalt condemn. This is the inheritance of the saints of God, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. Isaiah 54:17. Praise God. Hallelujah. You got to stand on that word like Peter did when Jesus said, come on out here. Peter walked on that word, the word of the Lord. Come on out here on the water. Hallelujah. You got to walk on the word. You got to stand on the word. You got to proclaim the promises of God and stand on those promises of God. You got a sure word, the Bible. And that's another thing. I'm tired of foolish people, and that's the right word, foolishness, trying to tell me that the word of God is not the word of God. I hear that every day from somebody trying to tell me that you can't trust the word of God. That's what the devil told Eve in the garden. Did God really say you can't eat of the fruit? No, God really don't want you to eat the fruit because you can become a God. That's where it all begins, brothers and sisters, when your people are attacking the word of God. Next time somebody tries to attack the word of God, say, get behind me, Satan, in the name of Jesus, because that's as straight out of the mouth of Satan. I rebuke that spirit in Jesus' name. Get behind me, Satan, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. God bless you all, brothers and sisters.